all God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on a telephone wire. Some just clap their hands, a pause, or anything they got. Now all God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on a telephone wire. Some just clap their hands, a pause, or anything they got. Now
listen to the top where the little bird sings, and the melodies and the high notes ringing, and the hoot owl cries over everything, and the blackbird disagrees.
Singing in the nighttime, singing in the day, when the little duck quacks and he's on his way, and the otter hasn't got much to say, and the porcupine talks to himself.
All God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now.
And the cats, they tick up the middle, where the honeybee hums and the cricket fiddles, the donkey brays and the pony neighs, the old great badger sighs.
Listen to the bass, it's a one on the bottom, where the bullfrog croaks and the hippopotamus moans and groans with the big to-do, and the old cow just goes moo.
All God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on a telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now. Simple song, a little song everywhere, by the ox and the fox and the grizzly bear, the dopey alligator and the hawk above, the sly old weasel and the turtle dove. All God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now. All God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now. All God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low and some sing higher. Some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or paws or anything they got now. All God's creatures got a place in the choir.
Thank you. that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe for the souls of all who had come to the Father are restored. And the church of Christ was born, then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not faint, by his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
And welcome to worship at Chowdene Church Online. My name is Stuart. I'm one of the church leaders here, and I'm just introducing our service and then speaking to you at the end. We're really pleased you could join us today. If you're joining us for the first time, or you're joining us for however many weeks we've been in lockdown now, we really do welcome you to the service and pray that God will bless you as you listen and take part. I want to share with you a verse of scripture today. It's found in Psalm 24. The first verse says, "The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded it upon the seas and established it upon the waters." And then going on to verse 7, it says, "Lift up, you gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your gates, O you gates, lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is he, this King of glory? The Lord Almighty, he is the King of glory." And these days we are just thinking about, I've got two big gates at my door, and they're closed at the moment to stop people wandering in and to stop us wandering out. And I just want to invite you this morning, as we come for worship, to open the gates of your heart, to be welcoming to God's Spirit. He wants to speak to you today. He wants to be whatever you need, whether it's a comfort, an encouragement, or just some love or a hug. God wants to be there by his Spirit. So I invite you today, be open, open your hearts, open your minds to what God's got to say. We're continuing our series today on women in the Bible, and we'll be returning to I Love My Church in a couple of weeks' time. And Ruth is going to talk us through a lady who she finds really encouraging in the Bible. I'd like to tell you her name, but we don't know her name. She's one of those people who just makes a difference but hasn't got a name that we know. Sure, she did have a name, but we don't know what the name is. So please enjoy the service today. Those people who already know, signing in, please chat with us during the service. If you've got words of encouragement for the speaker, or you've enjoyed the song or anything like that, just chat on there and put a comment in. If you need prayer, press the moments button and someone will pray with you this morning during the service. Enjoy today, and God bless you as we worship together. Bless all of us in Jesus' name.
I love faith, everybody. Really glad you could join us this morning for our service online. In Sunday School, last week, this week and next week, we're looking at Story Keepers, Episode 9. Now, the theme of this episode is, who is Jesus? What was so special about him? And how should we react to him? I asked some of you this week to tell me who you think Jesus is and what's special about him. So let's hear from Dan and Amira what they think.
Dan, who do you think Jesus is?
I think Jesus is a man and he's also God. I think he's kind, generous, and he's kind of a superhero.
Amira, what is special about Jesus?
He loves everyone and he's kind.
So Amira thought Jesus loved everyone and was kind, and Dan thought he was a sort of superhero. I wonder if you sang the song from the PAX last week, Jesus Superhero, the only one who could change the world. Well, the people who were around when Jesus was here on earth would have agreed with you. They thought Jesus was loving and kind. He did amazing things. They wouldn't have thought superhero, because superheroes hadn't been invented then. But he could feed them. He could give them wine. He healed sick people. He could calm storms. Boy, if he was their king, life would be wonderful. Much better than those cruel Romans. They really wanted him to be king. And as he came into Jerusalem, in a story we looked at a few weeks ago and we're looking at again today, people gathered and cheered. Jesus, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, save us. John says, don't be afraid, Jerusalem. See, your king is coming, seated on a donkey. And they really hoped he would be the king. But Jesus wasn't the sort of king they were expecting. He didn't need an army with tanks and ballistic missiles. He didn't need a navy with aircraft carriers and destroyers. He didn't even need to attack the cruel Romans to get power over them. You see, he's actually the king of kings. So whether the Romans knew it or not, he was their king. Nero, in Story Keepers, thought he was so wonderful, so great, so amazing. But actually, he didn't know that Jesus was his king. Jesus is fighting a battle. He's already won the victory, but there are still little battles going on. But he's not fighting against people. He's not fighting with armies like people fight these days. I'll give you a clue, the sort of weapons that he uses. If we look at what happens after he arrived in Jerusalem on the donkey, while everybody had been cheering and shouting and waving and praising God, and they then went into the temple. The adults, of course, knew that when you went into the temple, you put on your sensible face and you behaved well. But the children didn't know that. They just still were waving their branches and shouting and praising Jesus. And in fact, the priests were a little bit shocked. How could the children behave like this? Jesus, can't you see what these children are doing? Why didn't you tell them to be quiet? And Jesus replied by quoting from one of the Psalms in the Old Testament. It's Psalm chapter 8, verse 2. And Jesus quoted this verse. The psalm says, with praise from children and tiny infants, you, that's God, have built a fortress. So he's not built a fortress out of great big rocks and really strong materials. He's built a fortress out of praise from children and tiny infants. And that fortress made out of praise from children, it says in the verse, it makes God's enemies silent, and all who turn against God are left speechless. That's just amazing. It's crazy. How can you make a fortress out of praises? But it's also amazing. I think that's why I feel that it's so important that children join in the worship, that children worship God, because that's how God's enemies are silenced. I hope you enjoy your activities this week, and I hope you're able to worship. There was a wonderful picture on the parents' WhatsApp group last week of the Walton children praising God and dancing with their parents. Please do join in again this week and post your results up on the parents' WhatsApp group so we can share them. Thanks very much. Bye-bye.
Good morning. I've just finished a run and I feel really physically tired, physically weary, if you like. But that's not the weariness I want to talk about. I want to talk about soul weary. The book I have been reading refers to soul weary as a type of tiredness that goes to the core, that goes beyond physical weariness. It's not uncommon during this past few months to have that kind of weariness. After all, for some, they have been locked in, homeschooling, not being able to lead normal lives. And for some, it has been illness. And for some, it has been death, unfortunately. So when I've been for a run, it only takes me a few minutes to recover and physical weariness goes away. But what happens when we're so weary? Yes, as you guessed, I was going to say there is hope. The Bible in Psalm 23 talks about He restores my soul. So whenever we feel so weary, we've got somewhere to run to, and that is to the Lord. I'm just going to lead us in prayer. So pray with me. Heavenly Father, Lord, I just thank you that you are our source of rest. Our soul comes to you and you restore our soul. And Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you that through your love and mercy, you give us a refreshment that we need. Lord, for those that are right now feeling so weary, I just commit them into your hands, Father, and pray that you may restore their soul. Some may be physically unwell because of the coronavirus disease, and yet some might be physically unwell due to something totally unrelated to COVID. I commit those into your hands as well, Lord, and pray for restoration of their soul and even restoration of their physical bodies. Thank you, Lord, that we are seeing a glimmer of hope through this time that we are in. Restrictions are beginning to be lifted and eased. And so we just pray for continued restoration where we will all start to live normally. We just pray, Lord, that you may continue to intervene. Yes, we talk about it a lot, but that is because we haven't seen an end to it yet. So we just pray for our church family. We pray for our friends, our relatives, that you may continue to restore their soul. Amen.
Raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. raise a hallelujah. Louder than the unbelief, raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody, raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm, louder and louder, gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. Raise a hallelujah with everything inside of me. I raise a hallelujah. I will watch the darkness flee. I raise a hallelujah. Love the mystery. I raise a hallelujah. Fear, you've lost your hold on me. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm, louder and louder. Hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. Sing a little louder, sing a little louder. Sing a little louder, 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 in the presence of my enemies. Sing a little louder, louder than the unbelief. Sing a little louder, my weapon is a melody. Sing a little louder, heaven comes to fight for me. Sing a little louder, in the presence of my enemies. Sing a little louder, louder than the unbelief. Sing a little louder, my weapon is a melody. Sing a little louder, heaven comes to fight for me. Sing a little louder, I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated. Middle of the storm, louder and louder, gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive.
Good morning, church. It's good to be here. I think you probably all agree that last week's sermon was incredibly challenging from Tim. It was all about using God's gifts, the ones that he's given to us for his service, no matter who we are. Now, the only problem with that was that when he was talking, I was sitting there and I was thinking at some of his points, don't say that, I want to say that next week. But I actually realised that maybe God just really wanted to emphasise what he was saying, so I stopped panicking and took a deep breath. And hopefully what I have to say will be acts more as sort of a part two or a supplement to what he was saying. So let's get started. Let me ask you a question. Who is one of your heroes? Now, it could be a film star, it could be someone from history, or who was great in art, or achieved something great in science. Well, let's ask another question. Who is one of your heroes in the Bible? You know, your go-to character when you want a bit of inspiration. I think I've said it before, my go-to character is always Peter. Why? Because I think with many of us, we get things wrong, and he did that too, and he always put his foot in it, and yet Jesus loved him and used him anyway. So I always go to Peter for a bit of inspiration. Well, this week we are continuing our series about women in the Bible. And I wondered, who should I choose? Who should I choose as a woman from the Bible for us to look at? Should I choose one of the big names? You know, Esther or Deborah or even Ruth. They'd all achieved great things and very well known. And Ruth was always a favourite of mine, obviously, because namesake. And I like it because it's a bit of a chick flick story. There's a bit of a romantic end to it. And I can remember as a little girl, I used to say to my mum, I'm going to grow up, I'm going to marry somebody called Boaz, and I'm going to have a little boy called Obed. Thankfully, that didn't happen. Then there's Deborah, another character in the Bible. Now, she's a bit more of a Lara Croft Tomb Raider type of character, all action and guns blazing. Or there was Esther, who was stunningly beautiful and had the king wrapped around her little finger. But I decided against using any of these. I thought, no, I'm not going to use them. I wanted this morning to not look at any of the big names, really to serve as an encouragement to all those people who are quietly and in an unassuming way serving God, and really to emphasise what Tim said. We're all different and we all have something to bring. I wanted to encourage those who feel that they have nothing to offer and that they're not important in church, because you are. You are important to God's church, and more importantly, you are important to God. So I want to look at someone in the Bible whose name we don't actually know. We don't know her name. She was a quiet, unassuming girl who had the power to change lives just by saying a few words at the right time. And by living a life that was such an example in the way she conducted herself, that when she said those few words, she was listened to. She only has a very small mention in the Bible, and everything we know about her is probably written down in about 40 words or so, but she had a really big impact. So, who am I talking about? Well, she was a young Jewish girl who was, in fact, was a slave, and she turned out to be the servant handmaid to a man called Naaman, his wife, and we can find her story and what happened in the Old Testament. Let's read it together, and if you have a Bible, you can read it in that, or you can follow along on the screen with me. 2 Kings chapter 5, verses 1 to 15. I'm reading from the NIV version of the Bible. Now Naaman was commander of the army of the king of Aram. He was a great man in the sight of his master and highly regarded, because through him the Lord had given victory to Aram. He was a valiant soldier, but he had leprosy. Now bands of raiders from Aram had gone out and had taken captive a young girl from Israel, and she served Naaman's wife. She said to her mistress, "If only my master would see the prophet who is in Samaria, he would cure him of his leprosy."
Naaman went to his master and told him what the girl from Israel had said. By all means, go, the king of Aram replied. I will send a letter to the king of Israel. So Naaman left, taking with him 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 sets of clothing. The letter that he took to the king of Israel read, "With this letter I am sending my servant Naaman to you, so that you may cure him of his leprosy." As soon as the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his robes and said, "Am I God? Can I kill and bring back to life? Why does this fellow send someone to me to be cured of his leprosy? See how he is trying to pick a quarrel with me." When Elisha, the man of God, heard the king of Israel had torn his clothes, he sent him a message. "Why have you torn your robes? Have the man come to me, and he will know that there is a prophet in Israel." So Naaman went with his horses and chariots and stopped at the door of Elisha's house. Elisha sent a messenger to say to him, "Go, wash yourself 7 times in the Jordan, and your flesh will be restored, and you will be cleansed." But Naaman went away angry and said, "I thought that he would surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God, wave his hand over the spot and cure me of my leprosy. Are not Abana and Parpher, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Couldn't I wash in them and be cleansed?" So he turned and went off in a rage. Naaman's servants went to him and said, "My father, if the prophet had told you to do some great thing, would you not have done it? How much more then when he tells you, 'Wash and be cleansed'?" So he went down and dipped himself in the Jordan 7 times, as the man of God had told him, and his flesh was restored and became clean like that of a young boy. Then Naaman and all his attendants went back to the man of God. He stood before him and said, "Now I know that there is no God in all the world except in Israel."
So, having read the story, let's look back quickly at the all-important bit that tells us the first thing that we need to know about our young heroine. What does it say about her? Well, it's found in verse 2. Let me read it to you. It says this: "Now bands of raiders from Aram had gone out and had taken captive a young girl from Israel, and she served Naaman's wife." Now, look at the key phrase there, "and had taken captive a young girl from Israel." So the first thing we need to know about this girl is that she'd been taken captive and she'd been sold into slavery. Those few words are so quick to say, aren't they? But what's the story behind them? That's the important question. I'd like you to try and use your imagination and picture what had occurred. In all probability, what happened is that during one of the Syrian raids, she was stolen and taken across the border into Syria. Perhaps the raid occurred at night when she was sleeping in her family home, and she was possibly aroused by the groans of those who were being killed and screams. Quite possibly her father would have been one of them. The Syrians had been a problem for ages, since the time of King David, in fact, periodically sweeping in, looting, pillaging and taking captives. It was probably during one such raid that she would have been taken. We don't know how old she was. She might not even have been a teenager. She was certainly young. Her eyes must have been wide with terror. Just think about it. When she saw those fierce robber bands swoop in with their horses, shouting words she couldn't understand and bringing destruction. The screams of alarm would have echoed in her ear as friends and neighbours fled before the menacing marauders. Possibly she might have even been running to hide when one of the soldiers scooped her up with a rough arm and put him onto a horse. She might have struggled to get free. As her captors headed toward Damascus, her young life was going to be forever changed. Gone were the ways in which she was familiar. Ahead was nothing but unfamiliarity. a foreign land, foreign gods, foreign customs, and a foreign language she wouldn't have understood. That tragic night, she lost all that made life precious to her. All her dear ones, her family wouldn't have been with her, her home, and even her freedom itself. She would have been taken to the slave market of Damascus, that's where they used to take them, and there she would have been bought as a slave. And then, as if it couldn't have got any worse, when the young captive was taken to be presented to her new owners, she noticed something terrible. Naaman had leprosy. He was a leper. Now, such a person in that time would have been banned from her village, and now she was expected to serve him and work in his house. Leprosy is incredibly contagious. It's a horrible, horrible disease, and she would have known that and probably have been very, very frightened that she would catch it. How awful. I don't know about you, but I'm pretty sure, and I've thought about it, if it was me in that situation, I'm not sure I would have reacted how she did. I know I would have been distraught, disheartened, and downright devastated. And I probably would have cried myself to sleep every single night. If I was brave enough, I might even have tried to run away. Would I have questioned my faith? I don't know, but I think it would have been understandable, don't you? And you could understand it if she'd had a bit of a rant and a rave at God and asked the question, why? Why has this happened? Why me? And I think it would have been more than understandable if that poor girl had actually hated Naaman. Hated him, loathed him, and detested him for what he'd done to her. But she didn't do any of these things. Now, how do I say that? Well, have a look at what it says in verse 3. She said to her mistress, "If only my master would see the prophet who is in Samaria, he would cure him of his leprosy." We can see that in just those few lines of text, she was not only confided in by Naaman's wife, but she had compassion for and felt sorry for her master. Look at those words, if only. If only. Care and compassion is shown in just those two words, if only. Now, the text says that she served Naaman's wife, and you've probably got an idea in your head of a handmaid, but don't get any ideas. It wouldn't have been all rosy. It certainly wouldn't have been like it's portrayed in Downton Abbey. By the way, one of my all-time favourite television series. Now, it wasn't that type of maid, but it was a type of close relationship. And his wife was obviously sad about the fact that her husband was ill and had leprosy. And she was chatting to the servant girl as she was getting dressed, I guess, or having her hair done. And it's in that moment that the girl is able to tell her mistress about someone who could possibly help Naaman. Now, if she'd been surly, if she'd been resentful, if she'd been rebellious, or if she'd been rude, then she would never have been in the situation where Naaman's wife was talking to her about her husband, confiding in her, talking sadly to her. And if she'd had any real nasty thoughts to them, she probably would have kept quiet and thought to herself, let him suffer. He deserves it after what he's done to me. But she doesn't react like that at all. She's quite happy to share the knowledge of how he can get help. What a beautifully simple witness. This is a girl who knows God. This is a girl who trusts God and is not afraid to talk about God, and who has absolute faith that God is the one who can heal her master of his skin disease. She bravely approaches her mistress with the words of wisdom and says, "I wish that my master would go to the prophet who lives in Samaria. He would cure him of his disease." This servant girl has real faith. She doesn't say, maybe Elisha can cure her master, or perhaps, but he would cure him. She was very clear and very strong in that point. Now, we don't know how long after her being captive this conversation takes place, but I think it would be fair to assume, and we could conclude, that for Naaman's wife to take her seriously and to be chatting in the way she was to her, it must have been sometime after she'd been taken captive, and she must have been working in the house for a period of time. If she hadn't have been there for a while and hadn't have been living in a good way, then she wouldn't have won their trust, and what she said certainly wouldn't have been taken seriously. But what she did say was taken seriously by both Naaman's wife and then by Naaman. He was desperate to find a cure. And that is exactly what happened. Not only does Naaman find the cure for his leprosy, but he also finds God. We can almost hear the awe in his voice as he looks down to examine his perfect skin and exclaims, "Now I know there is no God but the God of Israel." What a statement. How wonderful. This young servant girl was so ready to share her faith. And she's the means by which Naaman, the commander of the entire Syrian army, comes to know God. We don't know what Naaman did with his discovery, but I think that we can be sure about one thing. Whenever anybody asked him, "How did you get cured? You're better. What happened to the leprosy?" he would have been only too willing to tell them how and who it was all down to. It was down to the God of Israel. Think for a moment about the people whose lives must have been impacted because of this servant girl and her faith in God. Well, obviously Naaman was one. His life was changed forever. But anyone who he spoke to or he was involved with would have been affected. Well, there was his wife. There would have been the servants living in the home. They certainly would have known. They'd have seen the difference. They'd have heard about it. You can imagine them talking amongst themselves, can't you? And then there would have been the people in the village. This sort of news is news that travels fast. Have you heard? The commander, he's healed. How did that happen? And then there would have been Naaman's extended family, the soldiers in the army. He was a commander of the entire Syrian army, so all the soldiers would have been used to seeing him disfigured and poorly. They would have seen his miraculous cure, and then they would have talked to their families about it. And because Naaman was such an important commander, he obviously would have gone with the king to see other kings in other countries, and so on and so forth. The simple witness and influence of Naaman's servant girl spread far beyond the home where she quietly cooked and where she quietly cleaned. Her influence spread into the world. She was a hidden figure. As a young servant and a girl, she'd have had no authority, the least amount of power, and the most lowly position. Yet, in the hands of God, she had the power to impact the world, and she did. We're still talking about her thousands of years later. Hers was a strong, contagious faith, enabling her to live without any feeling of homesickness in an alien land and any resentment against her captors. That's amazing. Her love for God inspired her to love others, to love her masters, and to win her way into their affection and confidence. She never hid her light under a bushel. Although only a maid, this godly girl did not feel she was too unimportant to influence others. I don't know about you, but don't you think that this is a fascinating short story? 40 words or less, but it teaches us the far-reaching influence of the humblest and most insignificant in God's service. It also teaches us that age is no barrier either. I think that sometimes we think we have to be more than we are to please God. I'll say that again. I think that sometimes we think that we have to be more than we are to please God. But we don't. When I was preparing this talk, I did some research on humble Christians who had served God. I actually typed that into Google and thought, I'll come up with a really good story that I can tell you all about and share with you and inspire you. I wanted to give you some real examples of people who had served God faithfully and humbly, just like the servant girl. But I couldn't find some people like that to tell you about. History seems to only record the great and the good, and those Christians that have achieved amazing things, like Billy Graham or Mother Teresa. Wonderful though they were, that's not what I was looking for. So I thought about it for a while, and I realised I was missing the point. It wasn't about things that Christians had done. And I looked into my own life, and I remembered a couple I knew that served God faithfully for many years, and I was surprised I didn't think of them before. Their early life had been lived far from God, and they only came to know God in their 40s and 50s. They were certainly rebels of their time. Neither of them ever spoke in church. Neither of them ever prayed in public. And as far as I can remember, neither of them did anything that would be described as notable in church. They didn't stand at the front or sing in the choir or do anything like that at all. In fact, the husband found it even a struggle to talk in front of people or to read the Bible in front of people. Why? Because he suffered really badly with dyslexia. Yet their home was always open to everyone and anyone. Every Sunday, and I mean every Sunday, it was filled with people from church. And sometimes people not from church. And the wife was always baking and taking meals to people. They would visit the sad and the lonely. They'd clean the church. And they'd sit with those that were dying. They would stop what they were doing every Saturday night at 7 p.m. regardless of where they were. Even if they'd been driving the car, they would pull over and park and just pray for 5 minutes for the church, the leadership, and for those in trouble, without fail, every Saturday night at 7 p.m, no matter what they were doing or where they were. They took God seriously, and they took serving God seriously, and they were known for their generosity. They were the most generous people I have ever known. Even after the husband died, the wife continued serving in exactly the same way. Neither of them were saints or perfect Christians by a long shot. They always referred to themselves as sinners saved by grace. But they loved. They loved practically and with big hearts, and their example shone out. They were known for their generosity and for their love and their care with their neighbours, with the people in the church, with the people in the little village they lived, but especially to their grandchildren. And their grandchildren loved them as a result. And because of that, they loved the God that they serve too. The names of these people? George and Betty Hayden, my mum and dad. So this morning, what do I want you to take away from all of this? What does God want from you? Well, it says in Colossians 3, verse 23, it says this: work willingly at whatever you do, as though you are working for the Lord rather than for people. Work willingly. That means with joy, wanting to do it, not in a begrudging spirit. Work willingly at whatever you do, as though you were working for the Lord rather than for people. Just like that little servant girl did. Now, you might say, I can't come to God. I can't serve him. You don't know what my life has been like. You don't know the things I've done and the things I've said, what I've done in the past, and also how rubbish I am at things. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter one little bit. One of my favourite passages, and it's a brilliant one in the Bible, is this: come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. The question is, will you come, just as you are, and give yourselves to Jesus? And instead of saying, I can't do this, and I can't do that, and I'm no good at this, and I'm no good at that, start saying, just like little Samuel did in the Bible, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. What can you do for God today? What can you do to serve God? I think you might be surprised.
You're the miracle, miracle, miracle worker.
Well, thank you everyone who's contributed to our service today. Thank you for being with us. We particularly want to thank the young people, the Sunday school teachers, the people who contributed the worship, and particularly to Ruth for her word today, just reminding us that you don't have to be a celebrity to make a difference in God's kingdom. Now, I'd like to particularly thank Chris. Chris every week spends a lot of time putting this service together, and we know he just has such a passion for getting things right. And thank you so much, Chris, for all the work you're doing. Now I'd just like to read this as a prayer and a blessing over us. It's found at the end of Hebrews, and it says, "May the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, may he equip you with everything good for doing his will, and may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory for ever and ever. Amen." Let's pray together. Father, I just thank you for this time together that we've had, for the word that you've brought to us, for the lessons we can learn from each other, from the worship we've shared. For our young people, we pray that you'll bless them and be with us during this coming week as we seek to serve you, we seek to do your will. Keep us safe. Keep us in your care. Bless each one now, in Jesus' name. Amen. And folks, we look forward to seeing you again next week. Please join one of the house groups and have some fun and enjoyment. And join us, as I said, for coffee straight after this service. Bless you. Stay safe.
Shadows deepen.
We do.
But do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through?
We do.
Do you wish that you could see it all made new? Honor and glory, is he worthy?